when I was at Cambridge, I really had a sort of perfect life. I had a wonderful laboratory. We built a new wing on the building. We shared the building with physiology, and there's a bit of war that always went on between the physiologists and the psychologists, and we always came off second best because they were sort of superior beings to us, you know, they sort of pecked us, so to speak. But I actually was amazingly lucky because I had the whole top floor of this new wing of the building, and I ran this as a laboratory. It's called Special Senses Laboratory. And I built an anechoic chamber in it for sound experiments. And I had a dark room, a very nice workshop of my own, in which I could make things. And also it could help the students quite a lot. It was very useful, actually, to have that. And then, not only that, I actually had a telescope in the observatory, in the Cambridge Observatory, because I got this idea for taking photographs through turbulence of the atmosphere and improving them while I was at Cambridge. They gave me the oldest and smallest telescope in the observatory. It was a beautiful telescope. It was, I think, 99 years old at that time, and in its own little building. It's absolutely delightful. And I had such fun with that. I modified it, set it up for our apparatus, and I worked with a very good engineer, Stephen Salter, who worked with me, for me, and we built this very interesting apparatus, actually, which I spent years on, and in the end tried it out in New Mexico and Arizona on big telescopes and so on. It really was a very, very interesting project, how to get better pictures through the turbulence of the atmosphere. It's a wonderful problem. Incidentally, that was financed by NASA by the American Air Force, just before NASA, for the moon landing, because we tried to get better pictures of the moon for choosing the landing site in 69. So all this was in the 60s, leading up to the moon landing. Anyway, all that was going on, you see, and it was at the top of my form, really, at that time. And then I got interested in artificial intelligence because the physiologists were not getting into the brain. And I got fed up with this. I got bored with the peripheral physiology, the retina and all that. But I wanted to know what on earth was going on in the head, partly because of the philosophy of it, you see. So the idea of making computers intelligent and seeing things was amazing, because you could then extend the philosophy into technology. Again, I thought that technology and philosophy and physiology and psychology are all, you know, helped each other. And if we got this going, it would be fantastic. So we tried to start a brain institute in Cambridge, failed because they got two subjects going at that time. Ethology was one, there was another one. I can't think for a second what it was, but there were two new subjects, so that we couldn't start a third one. So we tried to go to Brighton, and that didn't work for various reasons. So in the end, Michael Swan, the Vice-Chancellor, set us up in Edinburgh, and I moved with Christopher Longuet-Higgins. We were both fellows of Corpus. He was a brilliant chemist, theoretical chemist. And we started this department with Donald Michie, who was already there, in which we built a robot called FREDDY, and it was a big department. We had 60 academics in it and lots of money. And it was only partially successful. We were too early. Computers were simply not up to it. And quite frankly, we weren't up to it. I mean, we didn't know how to program computers. Christopher learned very well. I never did learn properly because I was made head of department. I had to administer it, which I've never liked doing. Christopher and Donald didn't get on terribly well together, which was a problem, and all sorts of other problems. And I really missed Cambridge. I had all this wonderful setup in Cambridge and my fellowship and free port in the evenings and all that. There we were in the bleak north, you know, quite honestly. I found Edinburgh, in a way, an amazingly beautiful and wonderful place, but golly, it's cold. It really is. And I never really settled down properly in Edinburgh. At any rate, we had this sort of dream of trying out our ideas, philosophical or technical, with new technology in order to see whether we couldn't make an intelligent machine which could see things. We were the first in Europe, and we worked with two American departments that had just got going, Stanford and MIT, and every year we came together in a big workshop. We wrote a great big book each year, which was a sort of Bible, really, of the subject. And there was some good work done, some of it was very good. And some of our students were excellent, and it's an ongoing department. I mean, it's a major department now, so it wasn't a waste of time doing it. But it didn't suit me, actually. It really didn't, particularly after Cambridge. So I decided to try and run my own small laboratory again and move to Bristol.
Why Bristol?
Well, A, I didn't know Bristol. B, it was near London. I got fed up being far up in the north. And I was offered a very nice laboratory, actually in the medical school, without having to build anything. I could just move in. And I got fed up with dealing with building. Actually, it was an incredibly funny thing that might amuse you. When we went to Edinburgh, we were offered a very nice large church for our laboratory, belonging to the Church of Scotland that had been deconsecrated. Then they heard we were going to build a robot, and the idea of a robot walking up the aisle was just too much, and they withdrew it. We got out there with no laboratory. We had plans and everything. It completely went down the drain. And we were there with no laboratory at all. And in the end, we got an army building given to us by Michael Swan. Michael said it would do well. We can get the chaps out in 6 months. They're still there, you know. It was bizarre, actually. So I gave up, you know, Cambridge and my fellowship, my very nice laboratory, which I really loved, with not a lot of administration and so on, for administering in a place that was far away from anywhere I wanted to be, freezing cold, but with very bright, excellent students and colleagues, you know. And we did, after all, start a new subject, which is quite a difficult thing to do.